brunette, a redhead, and a woman of a certain hair color were all shipwrecked on an island. They worked together. They built themselves a small shelter near a small stream where they could get fresh water. But then it came time they needed to do more. The brunette said since she was in the Girl Scouts, she had learned how to build a fire by rubbing sticks together, and she offered to gather up sticks and build a fire so they could keep warm, and also if they could catch anything or find anything they needed to cook, they could cook their meals. Redhead said, well, I was in the military, and I learned about which plants are edible and which ones are not, so she volunteered to go get some plants so they could eat. They both looked at the woman of a certain hair color, asked her if she had learned any survival skills. Was she in the Girl Scouts? Was she in the Brownies? Was she in the military? No, I've never been in those, but I could catch animals. That'll be easy. I'll catch the food. Brunette and the redhead were impressed. They watched the woman of a certain hair color going off into the jungle of the island. In a short time, the brunette had a nice fire going where they could get warm and they could cook any food that they might get. The redhead came back with some edible berries and some leaves they could eat. But they were both absolutely impressed when they saw the woman of a certain hair color come back with several animals and birds that she had caught. They asked her, what kind of snare did you use to capture those animals and so many different kinds of animals? Well, I don't know how to build a snare. Well, how'd you catch them? Well, I threw a bunch of sticks down on the ground. I caught them that way. Well, how did that work? Woman of a certain hair color replied, well, duh, everyone knows that sticks are sticky. Apparently she was a lot smarter than we gave her credit for, aren't we? Building a snare to catch wild animals does take some skill, but our adversary, the devil, Satan, is always putting snares around us and in front of us and behind us, trying to capture us. In Judges chapter 8, we can read about a lot of the snares that Gideon and then the Israelite people faced. Today, I want to look at Judges 8. I want to look at the snares that Gideon and the Israelites faced and what we can learn about dealing with snares and traps that Satan tries to use on us. But first, let's begin with prayer. Lord, I am thankful that you have let us be able to know about Satan, the adversary, to know that he's going to put snares in our lives. And Lord, we just ask that you would help us to recognize those and to avoid them. Help us to figure out what we can do to live faithful for you at all times, no matter what situation we find ourselves in. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm praying all of you have been following along with our Bible reading program, so you've already read through Judges chapter 8 prior to coming in. I don't plan on reading the full text today, but I will be alluding to it. So let me begin by first looking at the first 9 verses of Judges 8, where Gideon faced the snares, that I say, from his own brethren, from your brethren. Judges 9 begins where Judges 8 left off, with Gideon, his 300 men. They're chasing the Midianites. They're pursuing them at the command of God. They're trying to chase them down and be able to free Israel. At the start of this chapter, the very first snare in Gideon's way to try and discourage him comes from his own countrymen, the Israelites, from the tribe of Ephraim. Gideon, at the command of God, he gathered up that army. Remember, we looked at this last week. It started out with 32,000 men. God whittled it down to 10,000. And then whittled it all the way down to 300. They attacked the Midianite army. The very first encounter that Gideon has with the Ephraimites is they start complaining against him. What is this thing you have done to us, not calling us when you went to fight against Midian? If you jump all the way back into Judges 6, you'll read about Gideon blowing a trumpet to summon the people to come and help fight against the Midianites. At first it was Abiezerites, the family line of Gideon, that Gideon's dad came from. They responded. Gideon then sent out messengers to the tribe, and they came from Manasseh, his tribe. And then he sent out more messengers, and they went to Asher and Zebulun and Naphtali, trying to contact all the tribes that were nearby to get them ready for the battle against Midian. I really can't see that Gideon was going like, you can invite anybody and everybody, but don't you dare talk to the Ephraimites. I don't see that's what he was doing. It's more like he sent out messengers to all the nearby tribes, hoping that people would come and answer and fight with him. Somehow the tribe of Ephraim was overlooked in the calling out. But by Judges chapter 7, verse 24, remember that was last week's chapter, We can read about Gideon sending out messengers throughout the hill country of Ephraim, asking for help. The people of Ephraim are able to capture and kill the two leaders, Oreb and Zeb. Man, everything's going great. Gideon is going into this battle. They are beating the Midianites. The Midianites are fleeing. They're getting slaughtered. Israel's getting set free from the opposition of the Midianites. But the Ephraimites complain. How come you didn't ask us? You know, I look at this and go, have you ever had everything going well in your life? And then people who should be on your side complain that you didn't do it the right way. You should have done it what we think. You should have done it my way. You should have asked me to help with that. Even though things are going well. And they have had their share of recognition here. That's what's going on. Satan is trying to discourage Gideon and his army with complaints from his own countrymen. Gideon handled it really well. I think this is fantastic. He looks at Ephraim and said, you guys just got done killing Oreb and Zeb. You killed the leaders. What are you complaining about? You have more success, something fantastic. I can't even compare to your successes. Ephraim gets satisfied. But you got to keep this in mind, because next week, guess what? We're going to see Ephraim complain again. But here it is. They're finally satisfied. So Gideon continues his pursuit. He comes to the city of Succoth and the city of Penuel, cities of Israel. These are his own brethren. These should be allies to Gideon. And when Gideon asks them for food, the people of Succoth and the people of Penuel, they reject him. They refuse to give them any food or aid. The people of Succoth and Penuel. I can understand this just a little bit. Because if you remember right, the Midianites was an army that had been covering over all of Israel, oppressing them. Gideon has risen up with his 300 men to go wipe them out. He has slain 120,000 Midianites, but there's still 15,000 Midianites left. Gideon has how many people? 300. The other army's got 15,000. They've been in charge and ruling for quite a while. And Gideon comes, hey, we're hungry. We're chasing down the Midianites. Can you feed us? They're going like, until they're defeated, we're not helping you one bit. We want to make sure we pick a side that's going to win. We don't want to go with you yet. You know, I never realized how bad it is that people want to pick the side that's going to win until I moved to my first ministry up in Oregon. Oregon, being on the West Coast, every time there was an election, I would be asking people before the election, who are you going to vote for? I don't know. I don't know. Day of the election, early in the morning, who are you going to vote for? I still haven't figured it out. Well, what are you waiting for? Well, I'm waiting until the evening, and I'll vote at the evening. I said, well, why are you going to wait until the evening? Well, I want to know which side's winning, and I'm going to vote for the winning side to make sure my vote counts. I was going, what? You mean you're not going to vote on the candidate with the godly standards? You're not going to vote upon the candidate that's doing the right thing or the issues that are doing right? You just want to vote for whichever side's winning? Well, yeah. I want to make sure my vote counts. I kept going like, what a stupid way to vote. I mean, the Word of God really shows us we should be voting according to God's standards. We should vote for people who take a stand for God, for God's morals, and vote on issues that agree with the Word of God and the laws of God and the morals that God has. But the people of Succoth and Penuel, they're like, hey, we'd help you get in, but we haven't figured out whether you're going to win or not. And we certainly don't want to side with you if the Midianites end up beating you. So we're not helping you. We're going to be neutral. What a snare for Gideon. Can you imagine you're trying to do the Lord's work in your own brethren? No, we're not going to help you, not until we figure out if you're going to win. So he was facing that. He was also facing the snare of his own people, his 300 soldiers. They were hungry, the hunger of his own people. They started this battle the previous night. They have fought and they pursued the Midianites all day long. They need a break. They need food. That could have been very discouraging. I mean, have you ever been with a group of people and they're getting really hungry? I mean, I think it's Snickers who has that commercial. You're not yourself. Here's a Snickers bar, you know. These guys are getting hungry. Can you imagine trying to lead them? And they're going like, come on, Gideon, we need a break. We need some food. We need something. Satan often tries to snare us away from God's work simply by even something as simple as your hunger. An appeal to take care of your own physical needs. Even when Jesus called people to come follow him, remember there were some people who objected, hey, wait a minute here. I can't go with you and follow you until I take care of some other physical need of mine. And Jesus said, wait a minute here. Don't let that prevent you. You either follow me or go do your other stuff. Make your choice. They can be snares against us, snares of Satan. Satan was out to get Gideon, to discourage him. He used his own brethren, the tribe of Ephraim, the people of Succoth, the people of Penuel. He used the hunger of his own people, trying to get him brought down and stop doing what God had called him to do. There were also the snares of what I call being outnumbered. Verses 10 through 12, we find out there are still 15,000 soldiers of the Midianites against his 300 men. Now those odds aren't as bad as they were at the beginning of the battle. Notice how verse 10 also points out Midian has lost 120,000 soldiers so far, swordsmen. Midian had at least 135,000 to begin with against Gideon's 300 men. Now it's down to 15,000 against Gideon's 300 men. But still, Gideon is greatly outnumbered. So outnumbered that the people of Succoth and Penuel are believing, Gideon, I know you beat a lot of people, but I don't really think you can win. How do you think that made Gideon and his men feel? Other people are going like, you can't possibly win. It's a losing battle. Give it up. Sometimes Satan just puts snares in front of us, trying to get us to think we're way too outnumbered. This is too big of a task. We can't possibly handle this. I think about this especially near election times, because I can't believe how much the media loves to throw poll numbers to us and trying to tell us, oh, you guys who are conservative, you're way outnumbered. You're going to lose. The polls show that these liberal people are going to win, and they try to discourage Christians from ever voting about godly morals and try to tell us your votes aren't going to matter because these liberal candidates are leading and they're going to win. And these people who are promoting abortion, these people who are promoting sexual perversion, they're going to win. Your votes are going to be useless. Don't vote. And there's a lot of people who succumb to the snares of Satan. We're outnumbered. It's useless. Why bother to vote? Why bother to vote for God's people? You know what? Even if you're outnumbered, even if you're the only one, take a stand for God. And vote godly morals. Don't give up. Don't listen to Satan and his snares out there. You're outnumbered. It doesn't matter. We're on God's side. There was also the snare of being outnumbered because there were still two kings left. Two kings left. They still had power. Zeba and Zalmunna. These two leaders compared to just Gideon, two against one. And both of these leaders probably had their very strong security forces around them. It didn't look possible that Gideon could win. But God gave Gideon the plan to go around and attack the Midianites from a way that they thought was secure and impenetrable, so that Gideon did not let Satan put a snare in front of him to stop him from obeying God. He went ahead and did what God told him to do, and he was able to defeat the Midianites, Zeba and Zalmunna. And Satan was trying to snare Gideon from his brethren. He was trying to snare him with the idea of being outnumbered. He was also trying to snare him, verses 13 through 21, of what I call the snares of punishments. When the people of Succoth and Penuel refused to help Gideon until after Gideon had defeated the Midianites, Gideon had proclaimed he had promised a punishment for Succoth and Penuel. And after Gideon won, he came back and he delivered those punishments for Succoth and Penuel. The punishments for them. For the people of Succoth, Gideon took their 77 leaders of Succoth and whipped them with briars and thorns, most likely leaving them bloody messes. I mean, if you've ever had to try to go through thorns and briars, you know it's going to tear your skin. And if they were whipped with them, you know that they were probably all bloody and messed up with that. The people of Peniel, he tore down their tower, he took their men, and he slew them. And some of you going like, wait, those are some of his brethren. Why are they being punished? Where's the love? And that's the snare that Gideon would have faced. He probably had others trying to tell him, hey, you know what? These are your brethren. Just let it go. We won. Let it go. Don't punish them. Be nice. Forgive. Let it go. And Satan wants us to think that there shouldn't be any punishments for people who go against the will of God. And when we stand up for God and discipline those who disobey the will of God, some people have a problem with that. And Satan tries to get people to convince us, oh, you're an evil person if you think they should be punished. What a snare. Calling evil good, calling good evil. He still tries to do it today. Don't fall for it. Sin needs to be dealt with. And after these punishments went on, Gideon brought Zeba and Zalmunna before him, and he questioned them about killing people in Tabor, Gideon's brothers and his mother, and then Gideon exacted the punishments for Zeba and Zalmunna and put them to death. After some people read the Bible, they look at this and they question whether or not that should have happened. Should they have been put to death? And Satan loves to get us to try to think whether or not the Bible is correct in what it's teaching us, that there should be a punishment for crime. And when Christians stand up and believe there should be a punishment for crime, people like to question whether or not Christians are really loving people or not. And do we really live Christ-like if we think there should be punishment? The Bible often reveals that God gave punishments. I mean, that's one of the themes as we go through the book of Judges. How many times did Israel get punished and have a nation come in and oppress them because of their sin? Over and over and over and over. And when you get into the book of Revelation, guess what? There's a big punishment coming for those who disobey God. Don't let Satan get you thinking, well, God is love, therefore there will never be a punishment for sin. That's a snare. And Gideon faced those snares. But in verses 22 through 31, Gideon faced the snares that started bringing him down. The snares that I call the snares in life. First of all, he was offered power. Come, rule over us. Let you and your sons rule over us. This offer of power and authority often snares many people. Many people will give up their living for God to suddenly become someone important and powerful. Politicians often compromise the morals of God to try to find a more moderate or more agreeable worldly view on some morals if that's going to let them get more votes and possibly get into a place of power. And some people have been willing to take more powerful positions at their workplace, even if that means they have no time for family. They have no time to worship God. Beware. Don't let Satan put the snare of power in front of you and lure you with power to the point you walk away from Christ. I find it really interesting. Gideon was able to resist this. Instead, he says, no, I will not rule over you. My sons will not rule over you. Instead, the Lord will rule over us. But then came the next one, the snare of riches. Here's what I want. I mean, Gideon says, here's what I want. I won't rule over you. Let the Lord rule over you. But instead, every one of you, give me one of your gold earrings from the spoils of victory, plus the gold crescents and the ornaments and the pendants and the purple robes. It tells us Gideon received 1,700 shekels worth of gold. Someone calculated that as roughly 50 pounds of gold. How many of you would like to have 50 pounds of gold today? At today's prices, that's over $1.5 million, $2 million. Yeah, there's a lot of millionaires today, but in Gideon's day, guess what? There were very few millionaires. That would have made him one of the richest people on the earth, especially among his nation. And one of the very first things he does with this gold is he makes a golden ephod, the garment that the priest would wear. They weren't normally made out of pure gold. They had cloth and they had stones on them. But he makes a gold one. It seemed like a good thing to do, to think about worshiping God, to having a priestly garment. That sounds amazing. But it became a snare to the people that they would worship this garment, this ephod, rather than to worship God. Watch out for the snare of riches. They get a lot of people. And then the next one I consider that he had was a snare that got him was sex. Verses 30 and 31 tells us he had 70 sons because he had many wives and even had a concubine, a woman that he was having sex with that wasn't his wife. Gideon had let his riches and his lust rule his life. His ephod was leading some of the Israelites away from worshiping God and the tabernacle to now worshiping this golden ephod. And he was slowly being ensnared more and more by Satan, and he wasn't even aware of it. The final snare that mainly hit the Israelite people was verses 32 through 35, when we read about Gideon dying and the Israelites fell for the snare of a lack of leadership. Once Gideon dies, it tells us the people immediately turned to idols. They began worshiping the Baals. I find it interesting that one of the very first things that God had called Gideon to do back in Judges chapter 6, do you remember what it was when he was in the threshing fold? I want you to go and tear down what? Your father's Baal idol. Tear it down. And as soon as Gideon dies, the people go back to worshiping Baal, the idol. They go back to doing that. But as verse 28 points out, for 40 years they had had peace in the land while Gideon was leading them and keeping them away from the Baals. But once he died, there was no longer a king, no leader in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And immediately they went back to worshiping Baals, even making Baal Berith. And I find that very interesting. Hopefully some of your Bibles have a little comment, tells what that means. Baal Berith literally means the Lord of the Covenant. Guess what? God already had a covenant with them. He is the Lord of the Covenant. But now they have substituted this altar, this Baal. He is now Lord of the Covenant, and they no longer worry about the covenant they have with God. The real, true Creator God, the real Lord of the Covenant. Now they're calling this idol by the title they had for God before, the Lord of the Covenant. A title that should only belong to God. And I look at this and go, wow. And then in verses 34 and 35, it points out they rejected, they forgot the Lord their God. They even forgot the goodness of Gideon and what the Lord had done for them. They rejected the Lord in goodness. The snares of Satan caught them. It does not take long for people to be lured away by the temptations of Satan that he puts out there so that they will abandon God. You know, Deborah and I have been here over 20 years, and I've looked back through all my little research paper, my information that I try to keep here. There have been over 600 people who have come to Valley Christian Church and placed membership here, many of them by baptism. A lot of them have moved away. A lot of them have passed away. You know, Scott comes here. He's been gone for 15 years, comes back here, and he doesn't recognize very many people. How many of you know who Scott is? Oh, no, because we're all different, it seems like now. Yet many people I think about are still living in the same area, but they're not attending church. Maybe not even attending church here. Maybe not attending anywhere. And I think about that over and over. It's so easy for people to know about Christ and then to walk away and go different things. To me, it's a lot like what the Hebrew writer speaks about in Hebrews chapter 6, starting in verse 4. For in this case, those who have once been enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come. In other words, they become a Christian. They know about God. They know about what the word of God says. And then they have fallen away. That's the Israelites. That was a people in the first century. And that is some of the people today. Because God puts these snares up in front of them. And people fall away. And for the Israelites, when Gideon's leadership was removed, when he passed away, even though they had tasted the goodness of God and his blessings for being obedient to God, and for 40 years they had had peace in their land, once Gideon was no longer there to lead, they fell away into idolatry. What attracted them? What attracted them to idolatry? You know, as best as I can tell, when I do my research trying to figure out what the worship of Baal is, this god of fertility, what I keep seeing was probably so attracted to them was it was worship through sensuality. They had temple prostitutes. There was the aspect that once a temple prostitute gave birth to a child, the idea was to take that child and offer that as a sacrifice to this God. So you didn't even have to have any worries about taking care of this child. It was all about just pleasure. It was all about having no self-control, just follow your sensual lusts. And so once their leader's gone, hey, let's just do what feels good, what feels right. Almost sounds like what happens in America now. The snare of Satan caught so many of the Israelites, and I still believe it catches people today. Sexual gratification, sex outside of marriage relationship, it appeals to the fleshly side of so many people. Christian people who will willingly leave their obedience to God and instead will obey their fleshly lusts. They will follow Satan. They will be ensnared by him, as 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 26 talks about. Watch out for the snares. Satan has many snares. He had many of them for Gideon, and Gideon was able to resist some of them. He slipped right past some of them. When his own countrymen, the Ephraimites, were complaining to him, hey, you got a lot of credit. You guys killed those two kings. Don't worry about it. I have nothing. Let's go on. Oh, okay, we're fine. The people of Peniel and Succoth were trying to discourage him. His own people with their hunger was trying to discourage him. But he slipped right on by. When they tried to make him a king and give him all the power, he slipped right by. I don't worry about that. Let God be it. But when riches came in, and sensual lust and sex came in, he fell for it. When he dies and there's no more leadership, the Israelites fall for sensual lusts. Beware. Don't stop following our strong leader. And our strong leader is not me, it's not Jared, it's Jesus. The scripture tells us to focus our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Focus on Jesus. Don't get caught in Satan's snares. Focus on Jesus. Lord, I thank you for this passage, and I thank you, Lord, for letting me be able to speak through this without coughing much. I thank you, Lord, that you are a wondrous and awesome God. Help us, Lord, to follow you and follow your word. Help us, Lord, to realize that we are people who need to realize Satan is trying to bring us down. Let us live faithful and holy for you. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.